Sorry about that.
We have the youth outreach, which is our former SROs in school, which, as you all know, we were taken out of the school, so now we have a youth outreach group in my division. So we deal with, like right now, we're running a teen boot academy down at the Aquatic Center at Long Bridge. We have 25 teens, so mostly juniors in high school, and we're running them through basically like a mini academy so they get to see what officers do and how we do it, kind of get a taste of what our job is, what it entails. And we do this in order to try and establish relationships with the younger group in the county. And we have our community outreach, which is what you guys do this day. That's the group that has the coffee with the cops and the conversations with the cops, all the outreach programs we have, where we deal with pathway forward, that dealing with the homeless, dealing with all the community events, working with collaboration with our other county partners. That's the one that's more in the forefront of what people see when they see the county. We also have what's called the business outreach unit. That's the unit that deals with all the businesses, mainly the restaurants and the bars in our town.
Can I ask you to please speak up a little bit? Your sound is a little muted. A little hard to hear.
See if I can get the microphone to be a little better. Is it better?
Keep talking.
All right. If the screen, the camera's working, but the microphone's kind of hard.
That sounds better.
All right, so our business outreach unit deals with all the bars and restaurants and businesses in Arlington. They handle the Arlington Restaurant Initiative, where they work with the bars, they get up in compliance, working with the zone, fire marshals, and all the other departments in the county to make sure they're doing the best they can to keep our community safe. We have training as far as the not over drinking, over serving, so if we don't get intoxicated within our community. Then we have programs that we work on with the safety and security for each of the establishments, as far as watching out for people, putting like the hip doll in the drink, the date drugs and stuff. So that group is currently comprised of one individual, so she is very busy right now. I'm hiring an intern for her, so she'll have another person to help out. Our division was started 2 years ago now. Yeah, 2 years ago, July. It was set to be 30 people. Right now, we're sitting at 9. So we're a little short, and that's due to the police staffing overall. They couldn't afford to get all 30 people. But we're working on increasing our number. We have brought on a deputy from the sheriff's department to help us, and we're looking to bring on another one. So they'll just stay do the same law enforcement activities that we do. So we're bringing them to the engagement with us. Those are the three divisions we have. Now, what we do, as you all know, we have different events throughout the year, whether it be the block party, whether it be participating in National Night Out, which I recommend that all of you guys get involved with. That's coming up August 1st. If you get your organization together and submit a request to the police department, they'll recognize it on the county website, and we'll do our best to stop by and socialize with everybody. So we do a citizen police academy, which is similar to what we're doing right now with the teen academy, but the citizen police academy is dedicated for individuals who elect themselves. We want the established residents of Arlington County. It is an 8-week program. It can go 9 weeks, depending on holidays. And what we do in that is you guys come in for 2 or 3 hours on Wednesday or Thursday night. And we basically go from nuts and bolts of police department. So every section of the police department, somebody comes in and talks to you. there will be community engagement, whether it be our SWAT team, whether it be our detectives, our training and hiring, our negotiation team, the chief of police, the deputy chief, so I'll come and talk. That's something we'll be running another one in the fall. It's something that we'll put out to all the neighborhood community. So watch for that on the county website, police website. I recommend that you guys, if you have the opportunity to put into that, it's really a way for you guys to get some knowledge about what the police department does, not only with the community, but internally, and also kind of gives you a chance to meet and greet with officers and find the more human side of the officers. Realize it's not all about the badge here. We're just like you guys. We have normal lives, but you know, we also have feelings and we go through a lot of emotions in this job. I'd recommend that you guys look out for that. For all the citizens we get. As far as what we do with working for our residents, for you all, we work a lot with DHS. We work a lot with Adult Protective Services. To try and hold events, like we talk to the cop, to bring you guys out and talk with us. That's another opportunity for you guys to know us. We'll be holding another one in the fall, in the national, talk to the cop. Let's see. The exact date on that, I'd have to look it up. But those are opportunities. I know we're having one at Compass College in Colton coming up in the fall here. That's a good chance for you guys to come out and talk to us. And the chief usually shows up there, the deputy chief. And it's a good time to get any type of questions you guys have answered. We're very honest when we come out to those conversations. And we really enjoy talking to you guys. That's what community engagement is about. Community engagement. Our philosophy is to work with community and make the community and the police department act as partners in dealing with not only crime, but the activities and events, the socialization. We've really started working with, I don't know if you guys know, the county itself has a community, the county that's outside the police department. We really started working with them also and bringing parks directly to it. We're hoping to start amplifying the amount of events we have, the amount of opportunities we have to be out there with you guys. I think the citizens involved more in stuff the county's doing, but being involved more means having been more involved in police department, fire department, sheriff, park, rec, EPS, EPS, all different employees in the county. That's in a nutshell what we do. That's what the nine of us do. I have myself, captain, I have a lieutenant, I have two sergeants. So we're a very busy group. I believe we're up to 220 events that we already had this year alone, and we're only in July. So imagine nine people doing all that work. But everybody that comes here is handpicked. Everybody was very energetic and likes to do the work that we do. So it makes it a little easier. Like they told the kids on Monday, the Teen Academy, this is a job, it's more than a job to them. It's something they love doing. So every day they come to work, it's not a day of work, but a day of life. And they really enjoy what they're doing. Trying to bring it to the chat.
Okay, we've got a question regarding the older population in Arlington. When do the police get involved? What kinds of things?
Well, we have the community events, but we also we work with Adult Protective Services. So when we have incidents that come up, some of the establishments in Arlington, the elderly housing, whether it's a caretaker or something like that, the police will get involved in that as an investigation if there's a crime going on with a caretaker or the facility not taking care of the individual. We also do a lot of work through our financial crimes unit with our community engagement team for giving training everything that's going on in the county. But I'm sure you guys can make phone calls as I do about people wanting to have you go pay for something with gift cards. Or you get a call about, you know, there's a warrant out for your arrest through the IRS or FBI or a court scam where you're supposed to be in jury duty and you don't pay money, they'll come and pick you up and arrest you. We do a lot of work with our financial crimes, and they do fantastic training. So if you all, we're actually getting ready to contact the senior center down in Crystal City, Royal Park. Hopefully do some training down there with our financial crimes on that type of stuff. There's a lot of scams going on there, whether it's cell phone or door-to-door, knocking on your door, where they prey on elderly individuals. Basically, because I'll tell you what happens and why they do this. They go for the older population. I don't know whether you know it or not. They can buy phone lists on the internet, and the phone lists they can buy them for 20-year-olds. They can buy it for people like us that are 50 and older. And if they get phone lists that have addresses and phone numbers on them, these get for every time you go on the internet and you click on something, you get accepted to somebody to go onto their site. They're collecting that data regularly. If you use TikTok, if you're not, any of those other public sites, they collect your data. Well, they sell that data, and those people will go in and they know they play a number game. They'll get tens of thousands of information for people. You're buying them from the internet, and they hire people to continually call over and over again. And it's a numbers game where they'll call you on the scam and they'll either scare you or confuse us. And people end up going, and we've had people spend $20,000, $30,000 on gift cards and get into these people on the phone. And once you give that number, it's gone, done. There's nothing the police department can do, just hand the cash over to them. So that is one of the trainings that we've been trying to amplify a little more, but I will admit to you, it hasn't picked up quite as much as we wanted to, due to the fact that my unit's only 9 people, or the financial crime unit is only 2 people now. So they're only allowed to do so much. That's kind of why I brought my unit in for a little work, because we can have 4 numbers, 9 people, so 11 people, which is the financial crime detective. Any type of crime that deals with the older population, something the police works with, not only the detectives, but with the Wealth Collective Services, the DHS, the county attorney's office.
Is there any value in reporting those kinds of scam phone calls, or are they from out of state and a spoofed number and there's really not a lot you can do?
Best thing to do is report it. We have an online reporting system that you can go to, and it's a simple report you can fill out. Also, for those types of scams, like the phone scam, your best route is to contact the FCC. They keep track of it also, but we also work with our partners, the FBI. And like you said, a lot of these people are doing scams from other countries, they're from African countries and some of the Asian countries. So they're out of reach as far as prosecution normally, but there have been several that we've gotten in the United States. We've worked with the FBI, and they basically successful arrest and prosecution. So the question though, is there anything you can do to reduce the scams? Here's what I tell everybody. If you have a plumber or you go to the doctor, they don't ever ask you to pay in a gift card. If someone's calling you, ask you to pay in a gift card, whether it's a police association or something else, whether it's something you're being arrested, they just can't. No legitimate organization, agency, department of the government is going to ask you to pay in a gift card. It's the same with your bank. Your banks are never going to call you and ask you for your personal information. They call you and ask you for your personal information, hang up on them, call the bank number, ask them if they've called you. Unless you're calling the bank on a known number, not a number that the guy gives you on the phone to call, but your known number that you have for your bank, you call them and they ask you for personal information. Then I would never, ever suggest giving your personal information out to anyone on the phone. The only time I ever do it is if I'm giving a car loan, I'm calling the USAA automatically, but I know the number and I know I'm calling USAA. I would never give out anyone's information. I get as many calls as you guys do. This is my work phone. I have fun with this phone a lot of times on my ride home. I get calls all the time saying I'm going to buy the IRS, this kind of listening. I'm one of the people who live 40 minutes away. So I enjoy having this fun 40-minute conversation with these guys, playing with them for 40 minutes. And I'll tell you, I've had some pretty nasty language spoken to me in the last like 30 minutes. They find out I'm goofing around with them. But that's kind of a game I play. I've gotten used to it and I enjoy it. Wasting their time, especially the longer I keep on the phone, the less people they can reach. The FCC, they do change numbers quite frequently, but they're a much larger organization and they're able to keep track of it and they're able to do a lot more things like this. We're very limited in our resources and working things outside of Harlem and outside of Virginia. The financial advisory team does work a lot of things with banks. They work a lot of things nationally with public police departments. So there's some things we can do, and I've been, when I was in charge of detectives, we try as much as we can to get the detectives onto federal task force. So that way they have a little bit of speed if something finds it happen outside, they can work with partners a little more closely to establish relationships for them. So if the phone scam, the best thing you can do is just not give them the information about them that day. But like I said, if someone's calling, asking for information, I don't care whether you're saying they're through the department of banks or whatever, please do not give them that. That's the best way to stop the scam. Truthfully, they do keep track of people that they do and don't call, and they keep track of positive and negative contacts they have. The more negative contacts you have, it doesn't have to be there.
I had a question about people going door to door. Is it a good idea to report those things to you guys?
They're going door to door, like selling.
Yeah.
They're supposed to have like a solicitor license from the county before they're allowed to do that. Now we know that the kids like selling candy and that, they don't have to.
What I hear a lot is, I'm repairing your neighbor's roof and I can offer you an incredible deal.
Yep, and those people are usually full of bull. They're coming from outside the county. Unless you know your neighbor and you've seen them do the work and you know your neighbor that they're doing a good job, always check references on people, make people show you that they have license, they're insured, not driver's license, business license, if they're insured, check their references, always check at least three references. Most reputable businesses don't go door to door. Now, I know there are some like Boston Pest Control and that. Some of those will go door to door. But those are companies that we all know. There are companies that there are roofers. I will tell you, there are roofers after we've had like hail storms and stuff. They will send their people to targeted areas and try and go door to door with people and offer to go up on the roof and see if the hail is damaged. I've had that come to my neighborhood where I live down in Fredericksburg. But those people are usually in a uniform. Those people are usually with companies that you already know, or those companies as soon as you go online, you can look up the company, know it's an established company, look at their business bureau and see if they had any complaints, anything positive or negative. Most companies don't go to what you want to go. Not worth it for time and effort with them. So send out flyers.
have a question here. Other counties offer free external security home cameras. Have you guys thought about offering free cameras for seniors that live alone?
Well, we have not. Write that down. I don't think you know any other counties that are doing that? Like an interior camera or exterior camera?
Okay, so if the person that could post that, if you know what other counties are doing that, if you could add that to your post.
Gary, my chat is frozen. So I wanted to ask the captain, also in terms of when you were talking about scams, oftentimes people get calls from somebody who professes to be with the so-called police association. Tell us more about that. Are those scams as well? Are there police associations that are actually asking for money that's gonna help your department?
I was the president of our police association, and we have never in my 28 years called asking people for money. I don't know of any police department that does that. There's groups like Tunnel to Towers, and some of the 9/11 ones that send things out. If they're mostly online, they help them ask for money. If people hear about them, they go online. They give their reason to them. But 99.1% I've never heard of. Police departments will never call you at.
So just hang up, right? Okay.
Or you can do what I do and have a nice conversation for 30 minutes. And I never tell them I'm a cop until the end of it. And I'll be like, oh, then you're with my department. So, yeah. Police are not a for-profit department, so we don't ask for money. Our money comes from taxes. So you're already donating to us for your taxes, just like I do. But they'll never call you on your phone or go to your asking for donations.
I also saw something, Gary, I don't know if you caught it in the chat, about so many people are running red lights and driving too fast in Arlington and other communities. Is there anything that can be done other than trying to stop them, but maybe it's a problem? Can you tell us more about that?
Well, you said COVID is contagious. When everybody stopped driving, everybody wasn't on the road. People started driving like the roadways of race horses. I drive 40 miles every day to and from work in a unmarked police car. It's got a spotlight on it. Things on it, and I will get past them. People doing 90 miles an hour every day. One of the biggest problems is, as you know, nationally, there's just not enough officers out there. So I don't know if you guys get on the highway much, but every time I drive home, I used to see troopers all over the place. I just not see them anymore. I used to see Fairfax County, William County. There's not enough officers in running calls. We are working to get the legislators to help us with some stuff. We just got approved last year where we're allowed to put the speed cameras in traffic zones and school zones. So we're only two locations where we're allowed to put them in right now. So you can't put them like on Columbia Pike or South 50 or Lincoln Highway or anything like that. That's something we're hoping to get changed over the next couple of years, because as you all know, technology is required for us to do the job. We did get, I'd have to check our special operations, but I think we got approval for 7 red light cameras. Those we can use. It's a matter of money and funding and approval, because you do have to get approval for every camera you put in. So those are something that I think are fantastic, because I'm a police officer, but every time I see a red light camera, I know I've got to stop short of that stop line, that intersection, because I don't want to take it either, because it's very, they don't discriminate against anybody. They'll just take a ticket to whoever owns that vehicle. So those are things that I would recommend to reach out to the county board and the legislature in Virginia, trying to get them to put up an Easter and give us a little more ability to use this technology. Those things, that type of technology, it doesn't matter about the staffing issues with any police department area. If you have cameras out there, they're going to work 24/7 and that's the maintenance. I think that's a way to amplify the number of officers we have out there, appearance-wise, and it'll get people to hopefully slow down a little bit.
Okay. Well, Gary, we're almost at 11 o'clock. Were there any more questions that you wanted to
wanted to ask if those traffic cameras are ever monitored by anybody in real time, or is it all fully automated and, you know, something you can review after the fact, but there's nobody actually sitting there?
Yeah, the traffic cameras are actually run by DES, the department. They're not run by the police department. They're monitored as far as watching for slowdowns and altering. They can alter the cyclist lights net. They're not monitored regularly by police department personnel. We have access to them through our watch test, but the only time we use them, like an event takes place, they get on the cameras to try and locate the suspect or vehicle and try and be able to monitor where that business is going. So they're really not monitored 24/7. They do have the ability now to the cloud if they are reported now. There used to be only, I think, 3 to 5 of them that actually reported 24 hours a day. Now it's all they do is the achievement of going into cloud.
I was going to ask one final question. Is there a particular telephone number that if people want to get you or Deputy Chief Vincent to talk about this community engagement division, is there a particular telephone call number to call?
Yeah, they can call my number, 703-228-4327.
4327. And that would be a direct connection with the community engagement division. Is that correct?
You can also go online on the police department website, and there is a tab for community engagement division, and there's another tab that says request the community engagement division, and then you fill out a little form. If you call me, I'm going to send you that website anyway, because we'd like to keep everything funneled in one area so that everything coming into one funnel so it doesn't get mixed up with different
people. Okay.
That goes straight to one person, and someone will call you back.
Okay, and Gary, did you get that information?
Yeah, I've got. I posted the phone number on the chat.
There's one information about scam or in-depth information. Then just fill out that form, and I'll get one of my former financial crime detectives. We'll have something else to come out and talk to you guys, whether it's this capacity or live. And they can give you a lot more in-depth presentation on it. I will tell you that when I was over there last year, we developed a website. So you go on our website and just type in like financial crime. And I have a whole web page now developed. Go into all types of financial crime, and you tab on the tab, and they'll not only tell you like what the crime is and how people feel, but all figure resources on where you go, both inside our police department and outside our police department for help, whether it be a bank or what we see here.
Okay.
Fantastic website, and I recommend you guys to go on and take a look.
Okay. Well, it's after 11 o'clock, and we usually end the session. Beverly, did you have anything final to say? You're muted, Beverly.